people are here who will be able to type in the questions if they arrive on the Facebook or they come in the Facebook page. Okay, now we are streaming live on Facebook. I feel very fancy and famous. So I think then soon we can start. I have my students coming in. And from now on, Attila, if you do not mind, I will allow you to handle admitting extra students to the Zoom meeting, and I will take the role of the moderator. And if you are ready, guys, I'm going to introduce you to your guest lecturer for today. This is the occasion we have been waiting for from the beginning of the semester. Please turn off your microphones because you can get into very complicated and delicate situations. Okay, for the sake of the guest lecture, I would like to ask the participants who are in the Zoom meeting to mute your microphones, okay? Just to avoid any kind of delicate or embarrassing situation. And of course, if you have questions at the end of the guest lecture, you are allowed, even encouraged, to ask questions. Then when you get the word, obviously, you can just, you know, unmute your microphone and ask your questions. So if everybody is ready, and I hope everybody is ready, allow me to welcome the participants here and in Facebook Live. Thank you very much for participating and thank you very much for coming. And all of you already very informed that this is a program which is supported by the former Members Association of the European Parliament. And under this program, which is called European Parliament to Campus, we have the amazing opportunity to listen to guest lectures from those people who were actually members of the European Parliament, who are former members of the European Parliament. And for this reason, they can give us amazing insight how the European Parliament is actually working. So my students who are here, you learned from me how the legal framework is working. Now you have somebody who actually did it in real life. So allow me to introduce Professor Davor Škrlec. He's our guest lecturer for today. And if you allow me, I will tell you a few words about him, though you already received his CV. Now, he knows what he's talking about, obviously, because he was the member of the European Parliament and MEP for the previous term, which started in 2014 and ended its term at 2019. He was the MEP representing the Green political group in the European Parliament. And he was not only an MEP, but he was a rapporteur. So the person who is responsible for the preparation of legislative packages in the European Parliament. He was a rapporteur of several legislative or legislation packages, including circular economy, clean energy for all Europeans. So he has the insight we are looking for. And also he is a professor of University of Zagreb. So he does not only know what he's talking about, but he knows how to talk about it. So I'm going to give the floor to Professor Davor Škrlec. And I would like to thank you one more time for accepting our invitation.
The floor is yours. Thank you very much, Professor Šapanos, for these kind words. I hope that this lecture will be interesting for the students, especially because the core of my lecture will be, so it is only one slide of this lecture, but I think that the most of the time will be about this one slide. And other slides will be, let's say, introduction in the topic. And at the end, I will try to show and convince the young people how environment is worth to invest in it, not just look at environment as a sum which is produced the cost for the society or for us personally. So probably I will start and pause the presentation just to make this as a more dynamic. And at the end, so we will have some poll, if I write. So you will have some interesting questions to answer, just to receive some response or opinions from you as young people, especially because we are now entering the process of the conference on the future of Europe. We are all interested what will be the result of this conference, and we older and not so older generation expect the huge contribution for young people, because we want to shape the Europe for you, not for us. So we will be in the retired people at that time, and we will of course support your efforts, but not on the way as a working active people. So I will share my screen with the presentation, and so as already is announced, the lecture is about the impact of global and European politics on the European Union's environmental policy. And just a moment to switch to the what actually designed this European environmental policy is our global environment in which we are living. And this global environment defined the global playground for the shaping of global environmental policy, and therefore also the European. They give us some provisional goals and targets, so we can monitor also achievements of this global environmental policy. And this global playground is mostly defined by let's say two players or two definitions. One is defined by the United Nations conventions, protocols, agreements, everything we can find as something which is signed by most of the members of United Nations or everybody, ratified in their parliaments and implemented in the national or national legislation. And here I emphasize four of them, which are important for the European environmental policy, but not only for environmental policy. If you look at the first one, it's the Convention on Biodiversity. Of course, that you will on the first hand think that this is linked only to the nature or conservation of nature, how to protect the species, how to let's say protect the forests, but if you look at the current development of the EU legislation as a whole, you can find that biodiversity is largely present, for example, in agricultural policy. So how to make the agriculture more green, more sustainable, and it could be only if we follow the rules from the Convention on Biodiversity, which is currently also in the negotiation process on the global level. So we have all or most of the UN conventions designed to from the period until 2020, and we have some of them which are continuously developed, or some which are now in the process of negotiation. And of course, we hope that will be, let's say, some kind make agreement of this in this year, or some which is started from this year, for example, like last two about the climate and sustainable development goals. So as I mentioned, this Convention on Biodiversity is linked to the agriculture policy and also to the environmental policy of European Union. Then we have the Montreal Protocol, which is also, let's say, it's somehow upgraded by Vienna Protocol. It is for the purpose of the ozone protection. So we know what is how this layer of ozone is important for us as living beings, not just for the humans, but also for all other living world, and how it influences on industrial policy, because so currently we use the, for example, air conditioning devices in the cars, in the offices, at home, and we from let's say the last 20 years we changed the gases which we use as a working fluid in these devices to be more ozone friendly and also to be more climate friendly. So there are a lot of consequences on the industrial side if you look at this, let's say, environmental policy. And last two, which are let's say agreed in 2015. 2015 was really a year with a lot of challenges because at that time the new European Parliament start to work on the circular economy package. Commission proposed the Energy Union, which was revolutionary legislative package, which changed eight legislative documents, very important for not just for the energy sector, but also for the climate. And so in 2015, we have a result of the Convention on Climate Change, again, United Nations. And United Nations Environmental Panel of Climate Change with the final document or final agreement is the Paris Agreement on Climate Change, which followed the Kyoto Protocol, which valid until 2020. In 2015, of course, we agree about the let's say the main targets of the Paris Agreement, and it was a historical meeting in Paris, which we all follow. European Parliament was prepared already in 2014 for this by the several resolutions to request from the European Commission to present EU targets on climate more ambitious that, for example, was proposed by European Council. And of course, all of these goals from Paris Agreement are then in somehow included or embedded in the European, not just energy policy, but also in the environmental and climate policy. And you can find in all directives and regulation some kind of referencing to these documents. Not just reference on at the beginning. So, okay, guys, we read these documents and try to implement conclusions from or some kind of recommendations from these documents. But you also embedded the goals, the goals or targets from. From this, and of course, if we as a European Union want to be the global leader, we want to be more more ambitious. So define the targets which are higher than or at least are as in United Nations documents. Another one, which is also agreed on the General Assembly of United Nations, is the Sustainable Development Goals for 2030, very important 17 sustainable goals with 167 actions. So I think that nobody knows the whole list just as just to list them in life, but everybody is professionally focused on one or several of them. And there are some which are also interlinked in the European policies. And also European Union developed even the more indicators for achievements or how or monitoring the process of implementing and putting in life this Sustainable Development Goals, and produce the annual report. I hope that you will find some time to visit the website, web pages of the Commission, with these very nice reports to follow how we are successful is in implementing this policy. Of course, the report consists of EU as a whole and also for member states, and so you can see how your member state is, let's say, ambitious in following United Nations recommendations. So that's, let's say, the policy part which define the playground for the European environmental policy. And we also have another one which is also interesting. It's trade agreements which EU have with different players in the world. The one which was not successful is a trade agreement with United States. We have a lot of debates in 2014-2015 about TTIP, this transatlantic trade and investment partnership agreement. Mostly, I will say, as a, of course, former Green MEP, failed because let's say the chapters which request from United States to implement European Union environmental standards are very painful for the United States. So they don't want to implement this. Of course, there is also investor dispute problem with United States. Though they somehow they don't trust the European court and justice system. And of course, with the let's say the President Trump election and some kind of protectionism of the United States. So both sides, European Union and United States, I would say, frozen the negotiations and continue to. Let's say to exchange or talk just on the marginal parts of the of how we will trade during the President Trump's term. I'm sure that you follow the United States elections, and with the President Biden, everybody expect that so we will probably. Maybe not start immediately about new trade agreement, but probably to be better partners in trade, and probably to convince them to close their to make their environmental policy close to the European Union environmental policy. A more successful trade agreement was with Canada, it's a CETA. So they agreed to follow our environmental standards. They also, we also agree about the new kind of court system or justice system if there are some investment or trade disputes. The good example is South Korea. Because before there are the customs tax from in South Korea very high for agricultural products from European Union. We also have the custom tax for their car industry. They accept our environmental standards, and finally we now have the benefits from the exporting the agricultural products to South Korea, and we also have the South Korean cars which have conformity with our environmental standards in transport in European Union. There are also developing trade agreements with New Zealand and Australia, and the new one with the Latin America. So the usually position of the Green Group in the European Parliament is against the trade agreements, especially if they are not included from our view of the position, the all or expected environmental standards, so when we change something, sometimes position was, let's say, to be sustained on the plenary, not against. Usually, the largest political group in the European Parliament support trade agreements. That's, let's say, some kind of the introduction to the political playground in the European Parliament. I understand that you do know what a structure of the European Parliament and political powers of different political groups. So I try to let's say in few pictures emphasize important part of the European Union environmental policy. Actual policy, the new one, European Green Deal. Everybody talk about this. You cannot find article, scientific or popular or in newspapers, not mentioning European Green Deal. But we still have a negotiation of most important part of this Green Deal. New environment action program until 2020 we have 7, and currently we have in public consultation, and public consultation was finished, but in European Parliament debate about this, so it's let's say at the end of the legislation process. Sustainable development goals, which we embedded in our policies, the new biodiversity strategy for 2030, the circular economy action plan. It's an upgrade of circular economy action plan, which was produced in 2018, and zero pollution action plan, which is, let's say, a complex action plan because it's interlinked the 10 policy areas, 4 strategies of the European Union, and 5 selected topics like agriculture and fisheries, economy and finance, research and innovation, climate, energy. In circular economy, for example, upgrading the waste management legislation to be more efficient in recycling, in a separate collection of waste, especially of the household waste, and to be more resource efficient. That's some, let's say, the main, the more important words in circular economy. More resource efficient means that, for example, one third of just plastic waste today we send to the landfills. The one third we incinerate, and just one third of the plastic waste we recycle. So there are a lot of efforts today to change the chemical structure of plastic to be more recyclable, so less to send to the incineration, and of course to change the resource from which we produce the plastics to be more bio-based, not fossil fuel-based. And of course the third action is to be in reducing the single-use plastics, which pollute our environment and produce the microplastic, which is another kind of problem. And for member states which have seas or oceans on the shores, it's marine littering is also the huge problem. But marine littering is, of course, something which is usually linked to the seas and oceans, but you can find also in the rivers and lakes. So I think that everybody in the European Union is somehow affected by this kind of water pollution. In European Green Deal, I will say that the energy, climate, and agriculture policy are most important part of the of this legislation in agriculture, especially farm to fork strategy, how to encourage the local production of food, and also how to reduce the footprint of the agriculture, especially related to the climate. Just a short look on development of European Union environmental policy. You see that environment action program started in 1973, so I was a child at that time, and now we are expecting the new environment action program. There is always link to the State of European Environment report, which is produced by European Environmental Agency, very important agency, which especially to the members of your parliament is a valuable source of information to make the political decisions. There are also other European institutions which are important with their contribution to the to making opinion, so personal opinion of members of European Parliament. I will suggest you to visit the resources from European Parliament Research Service. So there are a lot of excellent materials, briefings, in-depth analysis, studies with a lot of references. So it's very useful if you make some research for your academic work or student work or thesis. So it's very nice materials you can find there. When we talk about the job of member of European Parliament, so I usually say that it's very important to have a wider look of the legislation of European Union. And I find a very nice graph which represent the three major targets of the seventh environmental action program of European Union, and how these three topics are linked to the legislation in several thematic groups, for example, the protection of air, chemicals, climate, nature, waste, water. And if you debate, should we be more ambitious, for example, in renewable energy directive, you need to know that it will affect other, for example, pieces of legislation which are, for example, in the group of climate. Or maybe even if even in some other parts which are not listed here, for example, effort sharing regulation is something which is not so usually mentioned as important part, but it covers all non-ETS. ETS is emission trading system, something which is market based mechanism to motivate the industry to invest in the cleaner technologies which less emission of CO2. Effort sharing regulation is focused on the agriculture and the transport of buildings, so everything which is not covered by this ETS. And this regulation is linked to the UN convention about, for example, transboundary pollution. If we negotiate something with on the UN level, so we need to then implement it in the EU legislation, then every member state's contribution to the EU level ambition. And of course, for example, if you want to be more ambitious, for example, in transport sector to reduce the emissions from the cars, then we will immediately affect the, for example, emissions from the agriculture. That's example that I usually present when we have debate in the European Parliament on the one of the last important legislation from the last term. It's a regulation about reducing the emissions from cars, vans, and trucks. And of course, there are always MEPs who are not in favor of ambition goals. And one of our MEPs is Bas Eichhout, is our green coordinator in the committee, convinced the MEPs by very strong message in his speak in the parliament, because he said if we not accept the proposed percentage of reduce of emissions from the cars, then we will be more ambitious in the agriculture, and it will be much harder to do this in the agriculture than we can do in the transport. And of course, everybody then recognizes that the food is very important, and that will be more complex problem to convince the farmers and to change everything what we have now in the agriculture, and reduce, for example, the consumption of meat or consumption of some other foods, which is relatively unpopular among the citizens in the European Union. Then we have to be more ambitious in the transport sector and reduce emissions from the cars and vans. And the result is that in this year you have all European car manufacturers by offering you hybrid electric cars, plug-in hybrids, or full electric cars, and promising that in 5 or 6 years they will not offer any new cars with the internal combustion engine. So that's really a good result of all efforts we have done in the European Parliament in this term, 2014-2019, because the results are, and achievements are visible today. So that's about this. And now European parliamentary side, so it's let's say more interesting part of my presentation today. So you know that we have political groups, and we have when we have elections for the European Parliament, probably if you are not independent, your political party is already the member of some kind of political party at the European level. And if you are followed the line of your political party, probably you will finish in the parliamentary political group in the European Parliament in which your national party belong. And so from my experience, so you really need to be you need to really have lobbying capabilities from the beginning, because when you arrive in the European Parliament, then you will exercise the political power in your political groups group, and also in the committee. So within the political group, you have national delegations. And you have head of delegation and member of delegation. And depending on the number of MEPs from one member state, so you can get more political power in your political group. So I was the only one green member from the Croatia, and so I was in dual position. I was the head of delegation and the member of delegation. But at that time it was very important for the Greens to have MEPs from the new member states, and I was successful in lobbying at the beginning, and in the first part of the term, so we are split in the first 2.5 years and the second half, 2.5 years. In the first part of the term, I was a full member of ENVI committee, so environment. And the substitute in regional development and transport and tourism. So tourism is very important for Croatia, so it's natural that I will take the transport and tourism. I usually say that so the problem we need to solve is in, let's say, ENVI and TRAN committee, and REGI is a committee which allocate the money for implementing the policies in the member states. So we can see that I somehow link the solving the problem with the financing the solving of the problem. In the second part, so even I was only one green from the Croatia, so my somehow I developing my political power, so I convinced the leaders in the Greens to change my committee, and in the second part of my term I changed the TRAN committee to ITRE. It's energy, industry and research. It's a committee with the about 80 members, so it's the number of MEPs is larger than in others. And in the beginning of the how will I say, assigning the rapporteurs and shadow rapporteurs to the energy union package. So in the first time I was focused on the circular economy and continued to be focused on the circular economy through ENVI committee and REGI, and then let's say the capture energy union in ITRE in the second term. But if you look at the other part of the how to let's say developing political power of personal MEP or national delegation or political group. So we have in the European Parliament intergroups. It's cross-party groups, so people from different political groups participate in the intergroups. They also are supported by the NGOs and different associations out of the European Parliament. It's some kind of networking, because if you want later to get support from the different political groups, if you are a rapporteur, for example, then you need, let's say, the good connections with the other MEPs, and it is the nice, let's say, the opportunity for intergroups to introduce the people and introduce to other MEPs and let's say the build the partnerships on the common goals, and then have a better communication when we start to negotiate about the report or legislation work, or even negotiation inter-institutional negotiations. Another part of let's say the building political power is membership with parliamentary forums. There are a lot of them. I was, for example, in European Energy Forum and European Forum for Renewable Energy Sources, but there are also a forum for SMEs, for industry, for research. So there are different. They usually grouped also the MEPs from the different political groups, but they are supported by different business associations, for example. For European Forum for Renewable Energy Sources will be supported by the renewable industry, it's obvious. European Energy Forum covers all kind of, let's say, the energy industry for the energy sector. If you look at the, for example, the SME forum, then you will have entrepreneurs, chambers of commerce, small business sector, financing sector. So there are a lot of stakeholders involved, and it's very useful because there are a lot of debates, roundtables, conferences on special legislative topics. So it's not direct lobbying, but it's let's say an exchange of view with the stakeholders which will be affected by the laws or by changing the European law. And then we have the Brussels bubble. So there are registered lobbyists who approach you as a rapporteur, shadow rapporteur, and let's say deliver to us their position papers. So it's a kind of lobbying, they try to convince us that their position is better than other position. And it's something which we in the Greens first introduced some transparency package to register all our meetings with the lobbyists about the topics, and usually we have support for our political advisor. Each political group have political advisors for the committees, depending of the how committee is large, is from 2 to 4 or 5 political advisors. They are specialized in the topics of the committees, and support us in drafting the amendments, in meeting with the lobbyists, NGOs, different associations, prepare us for the media, for example, interviews, or when they want to, or when we are asked to write some article or something else to share our position, then we share position of the group, of course. And I here, let's say, emphasize two which are more powerful, let's say, or active and political, for example, who inform us about our political environment. And of course, we have citizens, not citizens in the Brussels, but citizens of the European Union, and citizens which are from member states where you are elected. So we are directly elected, and we are responsible to our citizens more than to our parliaments or to our governments, and we need to listen to our citizens. That's the first rule of the ethical rule of the MEP, and that something we are in the conflict with the position of our governments, because sometimes which are on national level promote as a national interest to be included in the European law is something which will exactly not contribute on the national interest on the long term, maybe in the short term during the mandate of the current government, but in the long term is maybe not contributing to the standard of citizens in each member state, or not contribute to the state of the environment. For example, you have a lot of infringement procedures from the European Commission because member states didn't implement properly European Union directives of regulation. Committee work inside at the beginning of the term, and in half of the term we vote for the governing structure of the committee. So we elect the chair, vice chairs, and the coordinators. So the chair is elected on the principle of political power. So it's distributed on the level how many MEPs are in each political group, and then each political group, according to this rule, have a possibility to assign let's say from one to maybe half of committees to have a chair. Then the vice chairs are also distributed or allocated on the same system. Coordinators are elected within the political groups. So every political group have a working group for the committee. And MEPs who are members of committee, not just full member, but also the substitute, can be a coordinator, and we elected our coordinator on, let's say, on the first meetings of these our working groups. The coordinator is very important because he will fight during the term for the reports, legislative reports or all initiative reports of European Parliament, and this fight is also defined by the political power of political group in the committee, because, for example, if you have 100 points, then political group which have higher number of MEPs in the committee because of political power in European Parliament, then he gets allocated the more points. For example, EPP and Social Democrats will get, let's say, the 60 points together, and 40 points will be distributed on other five players. For example, the Greens, Renewals, then GUE. So there are others which are currently today, or which, or when I was in the European Parliament. And when the how is going procedure on allocating the of allocating the files, you have in the governing structure of European Parliament the conference of committee chairs. So there are chairs of the committees, and they on monthly basis discuss about allocations of the legislative files from the Commission, or opinions on, for example, on communication which Commission sent to the European Parliament and to other European institutions, on our own initiative reports. And coordinators then, so they decide what committee will do, what is under committee responsibility. Sometimes this is, they have shared responsibility. It was, for example, in some legislative parts, ITRE and ENVI share responsibility, or ENVI and transport share some responsibility. Agriculture and fisheries share some responsibility. So then they assign two rapporteurs, not only one. And rapporteurs are assigned, of course, according to the rule or according to the political power on the meeting of the committee of conference of the committee chairs. So when the document is assigned to the committee on committee meeting, it's a committee bureau with chair, vice chairs, coordinators. They decide then again on political power who will spend their points on some let's say the file which is of interest for the group, who will be rapporteur or shadow rapporteur for the files. So then start the work, and the rapporteur, so we have the several interactions during the committee work with the exchange of views with the rapporteur before he produce or she produce the report, and after, before we draft the amendments. When we draft amendments, then there is also deadline for drafting for each file. After that, we have internal meetings, so rapporteur with shadow rapporteurs, and let's say the more efficient rapporteur is one which is successful in integrate more amendments in one which is called compromise. Means compromise that we agree about the text of the amendment to the report or to the legislative report that satisfies most of us, for example. That means during the voting on the committee, the most of MEPs will vote for the compromise, so that will be included as the final text for the plenary. And usually you have here the groupings, left, right, if something which is good for everything, that it's a great coalition of everybody. It's not so often, so usually you have, for example, in my time, Greens, then left, S&D, and sometimes Liberals, who are with us, another party is EPP, Conservatives, non-attached, for example. So it's at the time when I was in European Parliament is, I think, better kind of work, because you are in the everyday contact with the colleagues from the committee, and through let's say personal approach, you can convince somebody to even to sustain. So if you sustain, then you will get more chance to win in voting for your amendment, for example, or for the amendment of the group, or for the compromise. So it's very challenging work, very very interesting, and also include the work of your assistants, because your assistants in some cases are let's say your hidden warrior, because or hidden negotiator, because they talk with the assistants of the other MEP. If I met you in the hall of the European Parliament, I don't know who are you, but we are talking through our assistants and negotiate through them, and of course sometimes it could be result, positive result, sometimes it's a negative result of these negotiations. During the parliamentary work, there are some situations when we need to have some special committees. In my term was a special committee for Dieselgate. I hope you remember how European car industry cheat on the real emissions from the cars. And another one is of pesticides, or how to convince the Commission and the member states to reduce the use of pesticide in the agriculture. So today we have something which was before in the intergroup for the animal protection, is the protection of animals during transport, something we've heard, artificial intelligence in digital age, special committee for beating the cancer. So you can find topics which are of wide interesting for the European Union, and each political group again assigned MEPs who will be in these committees. And for the end of this slide, I will just focus on the citizens. I already mentioned that because we are directly elected on European Parliament elections, it's our obligation to communicate with citizens on daily basis, so to answer on their emails, on the phone calls, organize meetings with the people who are from our member states, but not just from our member states. We are also present on the conferences, roundtables in other member states, so during even outside the member state, not as a part of the official EP delegation, but for example, I was present on the conferences or even on some not conferences organized by political groups or organizations, but also on, by industry. So in Netherlands, in Slovenia, in Germany, Austria, France. So really, lot of interactions with the citizens, scientists, people who are interested in environment, environmental protection, in climate, people who have some problems on the local level. So we are not, we don't have power to solve the problems of the on the local level, but then we can send a letter or request a meeting with the minister of or mayor and trying to convince this person to, let's say, receive the citizens on some kind of meeting or take account what happened on the local level. And you have here the one great tool, it's European Citizen Initiative. One which was the most powerful in my turn was Right to Water. So that's something which European Commission handled. So they, on the request from the citizens, open the initiative, and you need to collect 1 million signatures from seven member states. Usually is much more than the seven, and but each member states have a threshold of minimum signatures they need to collect. So we have a huge campaign from the groups who initiate this. And as I said, the Right to Water was one which was most successful during my term. And of course, the initiate or result is that citizens have a tool to request European Commission to work on the EU legislation and to propose this legislation to the European Parliament. So that's something which I think is more recognized in the western part, not so much in the eastern part of European Union, but really recommended tool for the citizens to be more engaged in the legislation process. And at the end of my presentation, I will just show you how environmental policy contribute to the development of the economy, how it is investment opportunity, not just the cost. And I usually link this to the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment, which nicely describe the services from the ecosystem which are offered to us in four categories, with provisioning services mean food, fresh water, medical resources, then regulating services, which we recognize, for example, as a pollination. So we all of us like to eat fruits. So it's something which we need to thanks to pollinators like bees, biological control, carbon sequestration. So we want to be more carbon neutral. So that's our regulating services from the nature, cultural services, so recreation, tourism, different types, spiritual experience, if you like to take a meditation on the lake or in the forest, and of course genetic diversity, which is also important for our survival or for the nature. Unfortunately, we don't have very well defined this economical contribution of these ecosystem services, because some of them market goods and services, so there's a marketable good or services is something which is not market oriented, and it's some value for future generations. So some people don't understand if what we are doing now for the future. Economic value of ecosystem services is something which is defined as a benefit that comes from the various ecosystem services, and it's free for us. So it's free from nature. Of course, that sometimes we need to invest something in this because we need to protect the nature, produce the services for us. And some numbers from one study from the European Commission give us just a better view of economic value of ecosystem services just for Natura 2000 areas. So it's depending on member states, it's from 20 to maybe 40% of the territory of the member state, but estimated value in 2014 was approximately 300 billion euros per year. The budget of now for pandemic is just twice of this, so recovery fund is 700 billion euros. So per year, Natura ecosystem produces half of this. If you look at the CO2 storage capacities of Natura 2000 areas, it is estimated to 10 billion tons, so it's equivalent depending on the market price of CO2. Today is about 40 euros per ton price of CO2, so it's obviously more than 1,000 billion euros annually is worth of the storage capacity of CO2 which we have in our Natura 2000 sites. But if we want to find the economic value of specific services, for example, natural disasters mitigation like floods or fires or something else, water supply and treatment, pollination, tourism and recreation, we don't still have adequate method of accessing economic value. And I think that it's a part of not just the circular economy as a, let's say, the new economy model for which we are fight and want to transform our economy, but also to the environmental economics, so to find the better economic models which we can then put in that model really economic value which is provided by our ecosystem or by our natural resources. So thanks to the European Parliament to Campus program of former member associations, I have a pleasure to give you a lecture, and I hope that now I will have some talk with the students and to answer your questions. I think that we still have some time, and I hope that you will also solve the questionnaire, and I will really happy to have some response from you and to look at this as a contribution to the conference for the future of Europe. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the lecture. The poll is ongoing, so I would like to ask those students who have not filled out the questionnaire just yet, please go ahead and do so. And by the end of the guest lecture, or probably soon after a few questions, I will close the poll so I can transfer the results to Professor Škrlec so he can react upon them. And I did take a few notes about the questions I have received in the meantime, but before I ask those questions, I would like to ask the students who are here in the Zoom to ask their questions, if any. You can ask a question by raising your hand, just unmute your microphone and ask the question, or you can type them in into the chat as well. Let me see, we have a question from Facebook, so just 1 second, because we are on two different platforms, we have to copy the questions from one place to another. But if you do not mind, in the meantime, I will ask a short question because I found it very sweet. Somebody asked that if when you give a speech in the parliament, in like the plenary session, aren't you nervous?
So the nervous is because you have defined time. So you have a 1 minute usually. If you are a rapporteur, for example, or you're presenting the political group, then probably you have 3 minutes. And from the beginning, you need to train to be concise in your speech. So and also to whom you send the message. If you send the message to the to your member states, to your member state, then usually you will speak on your national language, your mother language, so you don't need translation to from English or from German to other. Usually, if you send a message to your colleagues in debate, then you will speak in English. And according to my instructions, for example, my assistants usually make a draft of the speech. Then, so I look at the text, make some changes or reducing, or if I'm not satisfied, then I say, okay, then I will make my own. And from the beginning of the term, so it's usually for fresh MEPs to read the speech. So that's it's more comfortable to you, not forget something or not go out of the time. That's also important because the chair will stop you and shut down your microphone, so nobody will hear you in the auditorium. And you will find that between 120, 160 words is something that you can send as a message in 1 minute. So short sentences which with clear message is something which you train. And after some time, especially if you are contributing in debate, so it's not plain speech. So the plain speech means that for the plenary you have agenda, and within the political group, the MEP is assigned to speak on behalf of the group. Or if you are a rapporteur, then you speak on behalf of the group, but also as a rapporteur, for example. But if you are in debate, so if you have if you are replying, so then you don't have time to prepare your speech. So it's something that you need to develop or make some notes, not to forget something, and of course it's then easier to speak in English because translation then will be faster and easier and more understandable. So sometimes if you are speaking your mother language, and if you are too complicated in this speech, then you make a lot of problems to the interpreters, and sometimes they need to short your speech, and then other MEPs received not exact message what you want to send. So that's, let's say, the most challenges you have when you speak in the plenary, and of course in the committee. But let's say in the committee is not, you are not so much reduced in time like in the plenary.
So you say you can, with practice, you can just do that.
Yes, with practice, you can just do that. And if you, for example, analyze the speeches of the MEPs, then you can find how much effort somebody involved in preparing the speech, how much they is friendly with the topics about his speech, and of course, how, let's say, what kind of message is sent. So you have usually people who are, I was call it like standby MEPs, because if they request the speech for everything, so at the end of the in agenda, so we have for example the debate about some resolution, and at the end when all MEPs finish their speeches, you have still some time, and then you have catch of the eye. Catch of the eye is that you raise your hands and request the floor, or before you approach to the secretariat on the or in the plenary, and request for the speech, and then you have opportunity to sit in the plenary the whole day and talking about every topic. So that's crazy, but you always have some who are talking about everything. Uh-huh. And of course, on Mondays, I think that is still, so now they have a lack of this opportunity because they are doing all online. But on Monday evening, after the official debates, so you have free speech, so you have your 1 minute speech to speak about topics you want. Mm-hmm. And MEPs usually use this for sending the messages to their member states. So they try to emphasize some problem which citizens have of or against the government position or local position. So against the commission, so you have free time to speak.
Okay, I got, thank you very much for the answer. I got one question from one of our Facebook followers. He asked, what do you think about the potential for China and EU cooperation in climate change policy related to green finance, climate finance, and carbon pricing? And what are the difficulties we face in the future when we are talking about China-EU environmental relations?
Oh, it's a very, very hard question.
Clever students.
Yeah. So, so during my term, when the United States or President Trump announced they will leave Paris Agreement, then in EU, was obviously that without the strong partnership with China in climate action will be impossible to achieve the global targets defined or proposed by the United Nations. But there are difficulties because there are different economic models, there are different political models of governance, and of course strategic interests worldwide, because it's not just about the climate, it's about the resources, specifically for the high technological devices we use in our everyday life. So we are talking about the continent Africa with the huge presence of the China, who helped their countries to develop their economies by but they use the natural resources for their economy, for example, for China economy. But we have in environment some surprising developments from China. It was in 2017 when China decided to ban the import of the unsorted waste from Europe, from European Union, and that was produced a huge problem from the plastic waste, for the paper waste, for recycling. In the field of the part of the emissions, so we have the development of the renewables in the China, but at the same time they develop the nuclear, but they also build the coal power plants. So we don't have tool to somehow to convince them that they need to change their economy on the benefit of the whole world. And but let's say some development we can see, but very slow.
Yeah, but I think we can also say that actually this is not going to happen like in 2 minutes. No. So the key word here is like patience.
Yeah, patience and the China is also so it's a market oriented now. So if United States and European Union and if influence on the others in the world to change their economy in the way of circular economy, then China will also change, because they need market for selling their products. So the first one was why China decided to ban the import of the plastic waste from European Union, because they discovered they have their environmental problems and they have the health problems of the workers in China, and they just said, okay, we will continue to import, but only clean, not dirty, dirty waste.
Got it. Okay, I have a question from Konstantinos. Are you willing to ask your question?
Sure.
Thank you.
If you can hear me, okay.
Yeah.
So it's a bit critical, but I guess. So you mentioned that protecting the environment is in our benefit, the whole world. So I was wondering, on your opinion, of course you're representing the Green Party, but are the EU's environment-friendly policies genuine attempts to protect the environment, or is it just a political tool to achieve energy independency?
Please, can you repeat the last part?
So I will repeat the question. If the EU's environment-friendly policies are genuine attempts to protect the environment, or just a political tool to achieve energy independence?
You mean energy independence of the European Union, or?
Yes, because right now the European Union has no energy sources, and 80% of our energy comes from oil, natural gas, but we don't have it here. We have to import it.
Mm-hmm. So I will say that that environmental policy is mostly genuine, because we cannot on this level, for example, produce enough energy from renewables in European Union, even if we have the huge potential of wind or sun or hydro in some part, but moving this energy from one part to another part of European Union is the technical challenge. For example, we have a lot of sun and wind on the south, also have a wind on the north, but if you look just to Germany, for example, they have a lot of wind on north of country, but not so much wind on the south, and they have a huge problem how to transfer the energy from the north to the south just in Germany, not if you look at the others. But why I think that is genuine, because if you look at the emissions, not just emissions of CO2, but emissions of other pollutions, it really affects the health of the people. And something which is, let's say, insider information that assurance companies lobbying for lowering emissions of CO2 from the cars, but it's not affected, its effect is not just lowering CO2 emissions, but at other emissions, because they found that more and more younger people are affected by the emissions from the transport on their health. And of course, this affects the profit of the assurance companies, because they need to pay more to the younger people for medical purposes. Another example is if you look at the agriculture policy, then the pollination is very important for producing the food. And you can read from time to time on the newspapers, or look on the TV, or even on the social networks, how our overuse of pesticides in the agriculture affect the nature and affect the pollination, for example, affect the biodiversity. So if you lose one or two pieces in the chain, then it's possible you will have collapse of the system in agriculture, not in the 1 year, but maybe in the 10 or 20 years in the future. So that's agriculture. Then if you look in environmental policy, in the littering, in the waste management, the solution in the western part of European Union was incineration. Incineration is a solution to reduce the landfill, but you again produce some emissions, and still you have the landfill. In the eastern part, the landfill is something which is more present, not incineration. So in each part we have some kind of the pressure to the environment, and we lost resources which we can use again in our economy. A lot of problem with the water pollution from the cities, just by the sewage, which is not so. Water treatment is something which is still developed in some member states. Again, any other kind of the pollution of waters, the marine littering is something which is most recognized, but you can find scientific studies financed by the Horizon 2020 or national resources, by GRC, by independent research organizations, how dissolvent of plastic in soil, in water, in microplastic influence the biodiversity, influence the human health. So just to link the environment policy, that is a single target to reduce our in the energy dependent, is not correct. So it's just one, let's say, the one part, but not only one, and not the major part of environmental policy.
Thank you very much for the answer. We got another question in the chat box. What is something you see as absolutely crucial to take global climate change now? So to make it happen, if I understand the question correctly, what would be absolutely necessary right now to make the climate change like something what you can reach?
Mm-hmm. I will compare this with the situation we have now in the pandemic. So we have pharma industry which developed the vaccines but don't want to share the knowledge how to produce this vaccine worldwide. And we are facing problem now, and we will facing problem in the following years, because they want to introduce some kind of the passport certificates applications which will prove that we are eligible to travel, but they don't want to share the knowledge how to produce the vaccines. It's the same time, is the same almost in the in the in the climate action. So we have solutions, but we are not not me, we. So our states, our governments, and maybe wider, maybe not EU as EU, but the parts of EU. So we don't make this technology achievable to non-developed countries, to the poor countries. So at affordable prices, for example. And of course, United States, European Union, Japan, Russia, China, they are the largest sources of pollution and emissions, but we also don't want, so there are no intention to help poor to also contribute to the to solving the problem. And another one, what necessary we need to change is for on our personal level. I usually say that we need to change our pattern, how we contribute to the to the emissions, how what kind of transport we use, are we prepared to make a small effort to change our diet? Maybe so. I have experience when I was in the Ministry of Environmental Protection, when we tried to introduce national day with without meat, and it was really, really painful and political suicide, I can say, because they don't accept this just small. So let's one day in the week eat vegetables, for example. It's also nice to eat vegetables, not only meat. And the last one which I can remember is that in some part of the Germany, they want to raise the price of the meat to convince their citizens to try to change the diet. And they have the, let's say, the citizens on the street who are against this. So to change on the personal level, we will do more for the global climate action. And then if you do this on the personal level, you can expect also results on local level, on the level of your city or county or any kind of the regional local organization. And then is an easy way how to will convince on the national level. So first try to from yourself to change, and be example for others, and others will follow you.
I'm not too happy to report that it would be highly unsuccessful in Hungary too. Make population not to eat meat.
Yes, but so maybe you didn't notice that we talk. So it was, I think that was a communication or something like that from the Commission about the new food, insects.
Okay. Yeah.
So it's a source of protein. And protein is something which is important for our diet. And even I was found in 2019 in Belgian supermarkets already chips or some also food produced from insects. So if we continue to increase in population and requests everything what we have as a standard 20, 30 years ago, then probably in 20 years we will have 1 year, 1 day in the week insects on the menu.
We will see. Actually, the question, the last question came from somebody who is from Belgium. So that was actually a perfect example. And thank you very much for the question. We have so many questions, but we don't have much time. So if you allow me, I would just ask one last question, because this is something I got from two different sources. One is, the question says that the rumor has it that the European Union will also prohibit the usage of plastic bags. Is it on the way or considering, or we don't know?
So during the Juncker Commission, at the end, the Franz Timmermans, who is now also the vice president, at that time he talked about the tax on the plastic. Mm-hmm. So you need to collect money from some source to subsidize products which are not, at that time marketable, and to make them more affordable to the people. The tax reform of the European Union is under discussion, so I don't have information should they introduce the plastic tax, we already have a directive which is obligatory for member states to introduce the reduce the use of single use plastics, so the lightweight plastic bags are among them. Mm-hmm. They try to find the solution in biodegradable or biocompostable solutions. So in long term, I think that the lightweight plastic bags will not survive.
Okay, hope that we're going to have a guest lecture like in 20, 30 years again, so we can come back to the insect eating and the plastic of idea. And I honestly hope that you are right and we're going to eliminate, we're going to eat insects. I'm not sure I'm hoping that very much, but I hope that we are not going to have plastics any longer. If you do not mind, I'm going to share the poll results right now. So hopefully you can see now the
results. Yes.
Do you see them?
Yes.
So, do you have any kind of comment related to the results?
So 100% think that we really have an important role defining global environmental and climate policy. So fine, I can agree.
For sure.
Yeah. And the second? I need to scroll.
Yeah, the biggest number of answers said that it's a 9 on a scale from 1 to 10, and 1 is like the lowest and 10 is the highest. So they actually say that the European Parliament is really important in shaping.
Okay, I think that the results are realistic because so every proposal which we received from the European Commission, the Parliament is usually more ambitious. But it's on the first hand, and especially in the committee which is responsible for the topic. And the committee, even the EPP MEPs or conservatives will vote for something which is surprisingly for this political group. But when we reach the plenary, then probably result is, or not probably, but usual result is not same as in the committee, and sometimes we lose, sometimes we make a compromise. So for example, in 2015 we asked for the 50% of reducing the CO2 emissions, which is now 55 proposed by the Commission. So it's only 6 years, 5 years. So that's not so even we just finalized the piece of legislation which defined the 40, and the 55 was on the table. And of course, in the negotiations with the Council, sometimes, of course, we need to trade for something. So we try to trade to, let's say, for less harmful solution. So if we cannot achieve what we want, then we try to negotiate something which will be the good position point for the next time of negotiations. So yes, we are important, but we are not in the authoritarian regime of parliamentarians are the most important. Did you write email or request meeting if you're MEP from your country? Never. So I will kindly ask you to do this. Probably they will be surprised, but even if you are interested in something, or you have a question about European policy, but something which also happened in your country, you can ask your MEP to send a written question to the Commission. And the Commission is obliged to answer on this question of MEP. So there are, in some cases, I send this written question to the Commission by request from my citizens. And that's a, so you are not question the work of the MEP, but you kindly ask him to ask Commission, because he or she has a power for to receive the answer on the question, and so that answer can let's say affect, for example, your future, for example, not political, but maybe activities in the NGO or in science or something else. So are you aware about the European Citizen Initiative of your tool? Yes, so it's also it's almost 40% no, so expected, because nobody wants to market the tool which can affect political influence.
I will. I am their professor, so everybody will know about the Citizens Initiative, I promise.
So it's nice to see that no, I will never support the 0%. So we have a good opportunity for the future of Europe. And we want to be elected as MEP and have opportunities. So it's a nice result. So I think that I present the MEP work is challenging for young people. So they want to change the EU policy like MEPs. So 13% is interesting in the national. So 25, almost a quarter is yes, but my political option has no political power. So maybe in the future, your option will get political power, depending on which side you are. I hope you are on the EU side, because we always have a problem with people who want to dissolve EU. And there are also studies from European Parliament Research Service on major areas of EU policy. What effect will be on member states without EU? And it usually shows that the cost for solving the problem, so cost for all actions we need to do, because we are members of United Nations, so we need to include some targets and goals. Nevertheless, we are members of the European Union or not. So it will be more costly for us. The energy costs will be higher. Environmental costs will be higher. But profit from the protecting environment, profit from regional cooperation, from scientific cooperation, for mobility of the young people within the Erasmus program or within the Horizon cooperation in different fields will be almost so it not be impossible, but will be much complicated than we have today.
I think that was like the perfect ending of the guest lecture, something for the students to take. I would like to thank you one more time to sparing your valuable time with us and sharing your expertise with us. If there are no other questions from the students, mm-hmm. or if there are any, are there? And if there are any, and if you allow me, if they have questions, because we are going to have like a wrap-up session next or 2 weeks from now, I will send you the rest of the questions if they have mm-hmm. any.
Okay, of course.
Like the experience of the guest lecture. So thank you very much one more time for being here. And I would like to thank one more time the former member associations to make it possible. And I really hope that I can have you back as a guest lecturer 20 years from now in person. No COVID in person.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the invitation. Thank you very much for listening to me. I hope that we will not wait 20 years to meet you again.
Yeah, hope so. Well, you can expect me in Croatia very soon.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
And of course, on goulash.
Yeah, of course. Well, you can take me on my word. I will cook you goulash. And students, if you're still here when COVID is over and Professor Škrlec can come for the goulash, you are also invited. Thank you so much.
Only one day in the week.
Okay. Sure, I would try to learn how to make vegetarian goulash, but that's something which does not exist in Hungary, but I would try to make it happen. Thank you so much for everybody's participation.